to the book of Revelation, chapter 21. Revelation chapter 21. And we're going to read one verse. This is a new year. And I got to thinking about that, and I thought, well, you know, we're talking about the life of Christ and what Christ has done for us and how we can trust him and be saved and that kind of stuff and some of the things in his life. And so I thought, well, you know, it's a new year. And so I came up with some thoughts about new things in Christ, new things in Christ. Well, there's sort of a summary of this in verse 5, chapter 21, verse 5. And he that sat upon the throne said, behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. These words are true and faithful. So this new year is here, 2021. And at this time every year, most people are looking for many things new. A new year, maybe a new outlook on life, you know. A new start, perhaps a new friend, a new hobby, maybe a new attitude. You know, we make resolutions. I don't make resolutions. I do through the year. I make them, but I don't reserve them for January the 1st or December the 31st. So this time of the year, the beginning of new year, it reminds us of some new things. Well, in Christ, there are many new things that are wonderful and to be enjoyed by every believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. So in this message, I'm going to list 12 or 13 things, I believe 13 things, that are new in Christ. And so let's remember these new things. Remember that when you were saved, you became a new person, which we'll talk about in a few moments. And so let's look at these new things that Christ has for us since we believe and trust in him. I have a slide presentation, and I forgot to put it in here. I don't think I'll have time to do it now. I wish I had remembered it, but I was talking too much this morning. One of my fallacies is talking too much, and I didn't get up here and set it up. But you can jot these down. We'll have a lot of scripture, so if you want to just jot down the references as we go and listen to them as I read them. First of all, in Christ, there's a new birth. A new birth. We know John chapter 3, the story of Nicodemus and so forth. In verse 3, it says, Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, you can't see with your eyes the kingdom of God anyway. But this is a different word. It's the word eido in the Greek, which means to comprehend, to understand. You know, the Bible says that he came into his own and his own received him not. And he came into the world and the world comprehended it not. Or they did not understand or get the idea, the real idea about the kingdom of God. That was Nicodemus's problem. He could not see the kingdom of God or understand it. And then when he got through explaining a little more about it, in chapter 3 and verse 7, he says, marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. Because he said, Lord, can I go back into my mother's womb and be born the second time? And then he explained a little bit to him, and he said, so then don't be surprised or don't marvel when I say to you, you must be born again. You see, with earthly understanding, we don't know about the kingdom of God. We don't understand about the kingdom of God. You can read the Bible all day long and all night long and all your whole life and still not know. Because everything that we know about God and about his kingdom, he reveals to us. It's the only way we can know anything about him. Now, he has a revelation in nature, and he has revelation in the scriptures, and especially in the gospel, you know, in the gospel revelation. But the Holy Spirit has to reveal the kingdom to us before we really understand it. You can read the Bible, you can understand the logic of what the Bible is saying, but that doesn't mean that you can actually see the kingdom of God. Peter brings this up in 1 Peter 1, verse 23. He said, being born again. See, you were born of your mother. That was a physical birth, or what sometimes we call a water birth. And then there's another birth, which is the birth of the Spirit. So we're born of the Spirit. And so Peter says in 1:23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. And so we have a new birth, but it has to come through the word of God. The Holy Spirit is the one who births us, but it comes through the word of God. Nobody is ever saved until they hear the word of God. The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. And that's why we need to hear the gospel, because we can't have a new birth without that gospel. The second new thing, in Matthew 9, verse 17, in Christ there's a new wine. I noticed that as I was going through and studying this word new in the Bible. And in verse 17, Matthew 9, 17, it says, neither do men put new wine into old bottles, else the bottles break, and the wine runneth out, and the bottles perish. But they put new wine into new bottles, and both are preserved. Now, what the Lord is talking about here, he's talking about the Jews and the Gentiles. The Jews and their ceremonial law, that is the old bottles. And the new covenant, the New Testament in the blood of Jesus Christ, is the new covenant. We have the old covenant, the new covenant, the old bottles and the new bottles. And you don't want to put any of these new things under the reserve of the old law, because the grace of God doesn't work under the old law and be subject to it. As long as you're lost in your sins, you're subject to the old law. You're in that old bottle. And that old bottle will burst, and you will die in your sins if you don't trust the Lord. When you genuinely trust the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior through the new birth, then you're put in a new bottle, a brand new bottle. And the old one is perishing. The old law is perishing. The ceremonial law is done with. We don't need it anymore. Many people believe the Jews will rebuild the temple. They can believe that if they want. And they might. I don't know. But it's of no value. There's no value to another temple, because the temple was a shadow of Jesus Christ, a shadow of good things to come in Jesus Christ and his death, burial, and resurrection. And they say the Jews believe and they desire and they want to go back to that new temple, and they want to kill the animals and all of that. But those were all shadows. And you know what they're doing? They're putting the wine into old bottles, they're putting the new wine into old bottles. And they don't need to do that, because those were only shadows. They'll just perish. But the new wine goes into new bottles. The new wine is the new covenant. It goes into a new creature. And when we're saved, of course, we are a new creature, which I'll talk about in a minute. And so we don't want to put new wine into old bottles. Matthew 26, verse 29 says, but I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. New wine in new bottles. And he's referring, of course, to his coming and taking us to be with him in heaven. Number three, in Christ, there is a new doctrine. A new doctrine. Mark 1, the book of Mark, chapter 1, verse 27. It says, they were all amazed, insomuch that they questioned among themselves, saying, what thing is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority commandeth he even the unclean spirits, and they do obey him. When Jesus came on the scene, he came with a new doctrine. He was a Jew. He was 100% Jew. But he didn't follow the old law. He followed the new law. He had a new doctrine. What was the new doctrine? Well, he was the new doctrine. The new doctrine is that the Messiah has come to pay for our sins, to die on the cross, go to the grave, resurrect the third day. And that is our message to the world, is this new doctrine. What was the old doctrine? The old doctrine was kill a lamb or kill a bullock, splash the blood all over everything, and do all of those old ceremonial laws. That's what that was all about. Because the Messiah is coming. And the blood that they shed from those animals was a picture of the blood that Jesus would shed for us. That was the new doctrine. When Jesus came on the scene, he wasn't asking the people to give animals as sacrifices. Although, as being under the law, he was subject to that as a human being after he died and accomplished what those shadows were showing, then the old law was of no value at all. And the new doctrine was Jesus Christ is resurrected from the dead. And we're studying in the book of Acts in our Sunday school about how that Paul is defending himself against the Jews and against the Romans alike. And you know what his defense is? His defense is not kill an animal and shed the blood. His defense is not go to the temple and do this and that or the other, or make a vow and shave your head and do all this kind of stuff. No, he said, I stand here because I preach the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's why he was put on trial, because he preached the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Isn't that interesting? That was his doctrine. That was the new doctrine. And you know, that new doctrine is the same doctrine that we teach and preach today. And that is the new doctrine of the blood of Jesus Christ that has already accomplished our salvation. Acts 17, verse 19, it says, this was on Mars Hill, of course, Paul is preaching. It says, and they took him and brought him into Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is. What is this new doctrine that you're preaching to everybody? The Jews don't like it. The Romans don't like it. Nobody likes your new doctrine. And so I don't have time to read all of that, but he just went through and just told the whole history of Israel and how God delivered them from the land of Egypt and all of that, and goes all the way through their history, all the way up to Jesus Christ. And he said, all this history is pointing to Jesus Christ, the Messiah. And that was his message to them. That's the new doctrine. That's the new doctrine. Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. Number four, in Christ, there is a new covenant. And you can call that a testament. Now, you're wise enough to know that your Bible is divided into two covenants, the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. We call it the Old Testament and the New Testament. There are two covenants. The Old Covenant was under the law, the shadows that we've been speaking about. The New Covenant is all about Jesus Christ, about his fulfilling his work to come to do the Father's will on the earth. Luke 22:20 says, likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. What's the old covenant? The old covenant is the blood of animals and the blood of sacrifices. Thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of animals were slain to get the blood to type the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, to picture it. But he says, this cup, we would call that the Lord's Supper, this cup, he says, is the New Testament in my blood. The New Testament is my blood. See, the Old Testament is the animal's blood. The New Testament is Jesus' blood. 1 Corinthians 11:25 says, after the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. So when we take the Lord's Supper, which the Lord willing we will do in January, when we take the Lord's Supper, you take it in remembrance, not of the animal sacrifices, not of the temple, not of the Jewish law, but of Jesus Christ himself, because he is the new covenant. He is the New Testament. He said, as often as you take it. He didn't say how often. But when you do, he says, do it in remembrance of me. Most tables that we call the Lord's table that we have in churches, many of them have in remembrance of me, or take this in remembrance of me, or something to that effect. And so the cup, of course, we know to be the drink in the Lord's Supper. And then number five, in Christ there's a new commandment. Now, this is a little confusing because it is a new one, but it's not a new one. In John 13:34, it says, a new commandment I give unto you, that ye love one another as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. That's a new commandment. Is that a new commandment? I didn't think that was a new commandment. But then when we go to the same writer in 1 John chapter 2, verse 7, he explains it. He said, brethren, I write no new commandment unto you, but an old commandment which ye had from the beginning. The old commandment is the Lord, which ye have heard from the word that you've heard from the beginning. From the beginning of time, it has always been that we are to love one another. That's old law. That's under the old law. Do you know that? Under the old law. But in John 13, it says, a new commandment I give to you. But it's still the old commandment. He drug an old commandment out of the old law and brought it in. You know why? Because it has to do with love. And the Bible tells us that the commandments rest on love. If you love your neighbor, you fulfill the commandments of God, the law of God. Because love has always been there, even in the under the old covenant and also under the new covenant. So it's a new one because it was brought out from under the old covenant and put under the new covenant as the same law. We're still to love one another. You were supposed to do that in the Old Testament, and now you're still supposed to do it in the New Testament. So we have a new covenant. Number six, in Christ there's a new lump. A new lump? Well, 1 Corinthians 5:7 says, purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump. As ye are unleavened, for even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Now, in this passage, he's talking to a local church. And he says he wants them to be one lump. And that means, of course, in the very beginning of that book, he tells us that there were divisions among them. And they were, you know, I'm of Apollos, I'm of Paul, I'm of Jesus, I'm of this person and that person. And Paul says, you shouldn't do that. You should be one lump. You should come together and everybody think the same, believe the same, and all local churches should be that way. If you go to a church and are thinking about joining that church, you find out what it believes before you join it. Because you'll join that church and maybe 6 months later you find out they believe something you don't believe, and then either you're going to cause trouble in that church or you're going to leave and you won't say a word, and then they're left with trying to deal with your membership. I've had it happen to us here a lot of times. People leave, they never say anything, and I never see them again. You know, what do you do with their membership? Well, there was one person in that church that they really should have excluded from the membership of that church. Now, remember, when you're excluded from the membership of the church, that doesn't mean you're going to hell necessarily. You're going to hell if you don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. But just because you're excluded from a church doesn't mean you're going to hell. It just means that they can't put up with your shenanigans in that church, and you're causing division among the people or causing problems or maybe a bad reputation for the church. And so they exclude you with the idea that they're going to continue to love you and accept you back if you come in repentance and confession of your sin. So he wants the church to be a new lump. And Paul says in Ephesians 4:22 that ye put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Here he's talking about the individual. You know, he wants you to get rid of all the old stuff in your life and become that new person and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. And that makes the lump better. You know, he's talking to church here too. You know, and most of the time, if there's a problem in the church, look at number one first. What am I in this problem? If we're having a problem, where am I in this problem? Maybe I'm part of the problem. If you get you straightened out and everybody else will get themselves straightened out, then we won't have any problem. And then number seven, in Christ there is a new creature. Now we know this passage, 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 17. It's a good one. It says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, be in Christ means you believe in him and you rest in him and you are in him and he's in God and all that, the Bible explains. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. And we would say a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Everything's new. Everything you do, everything you think, your attitude, everything's new. And you say, why is it new? Well, it's because you're seeing it from a different perspective. You're seeing life from a different perspective. Because God makes you a new creation inside, and you don't look at the world the way you used to. Now, your body is still in the world, and your body still tends towards sin, and you as a believer will sin because it's your tendency in your body to sin. But in that new creation that God puts in us, with the Holy Spirit being the main part of that, he influences us to do good and to get rid of sin, and he convicts us of our sin, and that's a wonderful thing. John 17:23 says, I in them and thou in me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. That's quite a fellowship to have with Jesus Christ and the Father, that we're in Him, He's in God, God's in Him, He's in us. You know, it's a wonderful, and then the Holy Spirit is there too. And we have that wonderful fellowship with God, new creation, a new creature. Number eight, in Christ there's a new man. It's almost the same as a new creature. But in Ephesians 2 and verse 15, it says, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, or we might say the hatred, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace. And so when he makes you a new creature, you look at things differently. And when we look at the Jew and the Gentile, we find, looking at it from God's standpoint, there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto them that call upon his name. And so there is your new man. Your new man is the coming together in the body of Christ, which is the local church, the Jews and the Gentiles coming together with one thing in mind, and that is to give glory to God and to spread the gospel and to learn and to grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord and be a respectable person in the world, a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. Because in Christ, there's no difference between the Jew and the Greek. And another place says circumcision is nothing and uncircumcision is nothing, but we're all one in Christ. That's the new man. He made a new man. Number nine, in Christ, there's a new heaven and a new earth. Now, you know, you can have all kinds of ideas about that, about new heaven and new earth. What's he talking about? Heaven. A new heaven? You mean the one where God is? Well, it wouldn't surprise me, because you know Satan messed it up. When he sinned, he messed it up. So maybe there'll be a new heaven there. But I think what he's talking about is here, this heaven right here. You know, we have this heaven that we live in. We have the space, and of course, then we have where the angels are, so on like that. And so all of that's going to be made new. 2 Peter 3 in verse 13 says, nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Peter says we're looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. That means perfect righteousness. There'll be in that new heaven and new earth, there will be perfect righteousness. That means everything will be done perfectly right. Can you imagine everything being done right? Now, that's when we won't have much of an opinion, as we talked about opinions this morning in our class about everybody has a right to their own opinion, you know, and that's true. We can have an opinion about anything. But when we're in this new heaven and new earth, I don't think we'll have an opinion. I think it's all going to be God's opinion, don't you? Whatever he says, that's it. And we're going to be happy about it. So we don't have to worry about having an opposite opinion or a different opinion from God. And so this is a promise. Do you remember when God promised Noah that he's going to put a bow in the sky, and I made a covenant with you and with the earth that there will not be any more floods like this to destroy everybody on the earth? And as long as the time is, there will be summer and winter and hot and cold and night and day, as long as the earth stands, there in Genesis chapter 8, remember that verse? That was a promise that God gave to the people of the earth and to the earth itself. Here's another promise, that all of that's going to be made new, and there's a new heaven and a new earth. Revelation 21:1 mentions that, and he says, and I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. Like the old law, it's gone. It's not effective anymore. We don't need a shadow of Christ. We need Christ. We don't need a shadow of his blood. We need his blood, see? We don't need a shadow of his righteousness. We have his righteousness. See, we don't need that old stuff. And we don't need this old earth. This old earth has really been our enemy since we were saved by God's grace. Now we receive blessings from the earth, crops and different weather that we need and so on. But this new heaven, this new earth will pass away. In other words, it'll be replaced with a new heaven and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness, and there's no more sea. The sea is a picture or a type of problems and troubles. And so there won't be any more trouble. There won't be any more problems. I don't know if you have problems in your life, but I have problems in my life. I know you do too. You heard about the preacher, I've told you 100 times about the preacher that learned in college that he was supposed to have 3 points in a poem, and he was going to preach, and he said, my title is Troubles. Point number one, I have troubles. Point number two, you have troubles. Point number three, we all have troubles. He's right about that, isn't he? And then the poem, Adam had them. And so he did his job, getting a good outline for his... And I'm glad for it because it's a short sermon. That was a really short sermon. All right, let's go to number 10 now. In Christ, there's a new name. A new name. Now, we could get into this deep, and we'd argue about it maybe, but I'm not going to get into that. Revelation 2, verse 17. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna. I will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knoweth, saying he that receiveth it. So this could actually be the name of Christ. Because, you know, nobody knows Christ like you do in your own life when you're saved. I don't know him like you do in your own life. I know him the way I know him in my life. And so maybe that's the name of Christ, which someone suggested. Or could it be the name that's above the mere names of the earth, just a name given to us? I found a verse over in Isaiah 56, verse 5. It says, even unto them will I give in mine house and within my walls a place and a name better than of the sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. I think that's our new name. I don't know what my new name is. Maybe I will when I get to heaven or get into the new heaven and new earth. Maybe I'll know my name. But I don't know my name. But it's an eternal name. I know God has named me something. I'm glad it doesn't say a number, at least, you know. But we'll have a new name. So either way, it depicts our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, a new name. And you know, we are married to him. And you know, when a woman marries a man, she takes his name. And it's supposed to be a name of honor, a name that they're honorably willing to take that name and to carry that name for the rest of their life. And it's the same way with Christ. When we take Christ as our Savior, believe and trust in him, repent of our sins, believe he died for our sins, we take on his name. And his name is so wonderful. And we're not ashamed to carry his name around with us. Number 11. In Christ, there's a new Jerusalem, a new Jerusalem. In Revelation 3:12, him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God. Now, this is not the temple in Jerusalem over in the Middle East. It says, and he shall go no more out, and I will write upon him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God, and I will write upon him my new name. There's another one, of course, that, and I had the reference under my name, but I didn't want to use it because I'm using it now. And so there is a new Jerusalem. In Galatians 4:26, it says, but Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all. See, the whole time that there was a Jerusalem in Canaan or in Palestine where the Jews worship, the whole time there was a temple there, the real temple was in heaven. That temple, that tabernacle before the temple, that was only a shadow of the true tabernacle in heaven. And the book of Hebrews brings that out very clearly. So the Jerusalem that is now, it's a wonderful place. Yeah, I've never been there. Has anybody here been to Jerusalem? Anybody here? I thought maybe somebody taking a trip over there. Many people do. I remember Brother Elton Wilson used to go about every 4 or 5 years. He'd take a trip and take a bunch of people with him. And they'd go over there, and they'd go to Jerusalem, and they'd look around, and he'd come back with about 4,000 slides, most boring thing. He'd show those slides in church, take an hour and a half to show about one-third of the slides, and he kept saying over and over, now, you really can't experience this because you can't smell what I smelled when I was over there. You can't hear what I heard when I was over there. And then he'd stay on one slide for like 15 minutes, and he'd go to the next slide. I'm thinking, oh, he's got 150 slides to go. But it was interesting, though. It really was. But that's not the new Jerusalem. That is the old Jerusalem, and it's gone. It's gone. The new Jerusalem has always been there. And that's the one that God is building up through his son, the Lord Jesus Christ. The mother of us all. That means it's the one that is very, you know, your mother is sweet to you. And mother is, my mother, I love my dad furiously. But you know, we didn't talk a lot. And we didn't communicate a lot. And he didn't discipline us. My mom disciplined us. And my mom set us down at the table and teach us stuff, you know, and stuff like that. My dad didn't do that. And so naturally, I was very close to my mom, you know. And of course, I missed her tragically when she died. But the Bible says this New Jerusalem is going to come down from heaven. Come down from heaven. Now, I don't know where it's going to be. Maybe it's going to be right where that Jerusalem is there. I don't know. It doesn't matter as long as I know it's going to be a good one. I don't care where it is. But it's going to come down from heaven, and that'll be the place where God's government will be run here on the earth. Number 12, in Christ there's a new song. Everybody looking for the new song. I remember the American Bandstand when I was a teenager. I remember listening to American Bandstand. How many of you listen to American Bandstand? Nobody. Nobody listens to American Bandstand? Let's see, Esther finally admitted it. Let's see. I knew she would. I did. I didn't like everything I listened to, but I listened to American. And you know what they would? Oh, how about Ed Sullivan? Anybody ever listen to Ed Sullivan or see him on TV? Where have you guys been all your life? Ed Sullivan is the one who introduced all these guys. He introduced Elvis Presley, and he introduced the Beatles. I remember the Beatles came over here looking like a bunch of sissies back then, many years ago it was, and he introduced them, and they began to do their little thing, you know. And everybody's looking for a new song, a new song, a new song. Well, there's a new song that we have that's a whole lot better than any of them. I quit listening to the new songs many years ago because I didn't like any of them. I just turned the radio off. And that's the best part of the radio that there is the on-off button. And I like it. Revelation 14, 13, and they sung, as it were, a new song before the throne. And before the four beasts and the elders and the man. And no man can learn that song but the 140 and 4,000 which are redeemed from the earth. Now my opinion, and it's only my opinion, that those 144,000 represent all the saved. Others believe that the Jews and all like that, and they can do whatever they want to with it. But I believe this is a new song that God gives to his people. That this song, and I don't think it's going to be Amazing Grace. Now don't get mad at me over that. Because it's been preached around this whole country and probably in other countries that the new song is going to be Amazing Grace. I don't think so. Because I've told you Amazing Grace is not a Bible term. The Bible says nothing about Amazing Grace. It does say a whole lot about abundant grace and a bunch of other adjectives, but there is no phrase in the Bible that says Amazing Grace. I don't believe it's going to be, though I love the song. I believe it's going to be a song. See, nobody can sing this song. Lost people sing Amazing Grace all the time. They sing it in the saloons. They sing it everywhere. This is one of the most popular songs the world has ever known. And they play it. When they're not singing it, they play it. On Westerns, you know, have Westerns, everybody's killing everybody, and they're back in the background, they're playing Amazing Grace in the church, you know. But this is going to be a special song that only the redeemed can sing. I can't wait to sing that song. I love music, but I like good music. And, of course, my opinion is not worth much, but I like my kind of music. And you like your kind of music. That's the way we are. Now, the last one is, in Christ, all things are new. That's our text. There in Revelation 21:5, and he that sat upon the throne said, that's God, Christ, he's sitting on the throne also. Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, write, for these words are true and faithful. And so he comes to the end of the Bible and closes it up. He says, I make all things new. All things. Everything's going to be new. So then, I guess heaven will be new. Everything. Well, that's part of everything, isn't it? All things are going to be new. And that includes you. That includes you. When you believe and trust in Jesus Christ, that he died for your sins, he was buried, resurrected the third day according to the scriptures, it doesn't apply to you if you're lost, if you don't know the Lord as your Savior. It does not apply to you. You will not be made new. But you will be reunited with your lost soul at your resurrection, you will be judged by God, and you will be cast into the lake of fire forever and ever. That's not being made new. But he'll make all things new. All things includes those only in the sense that hell will still be real. Hell will be hotter than ever. Hell will be full. There is no space in hell. Because you know the Bible says in the book of Isaiah, hell has enlarged itself to meet thee at thy coming. So it's like a balloon that's full, you know, and it expands a little bit to receive a little bit more, you know, like it's going to pop. That's what hell is. So hell is not this big spacey place where you're going to go and have fun and run around with your friends. No, it's a very tight place. Because the Bible says that in my Father's house are many mansions. Somebody said that means rooms. I don't care if it's mansions or rooms, it makes a difference to me. But it indicates it's going to be a lot, there's going to be a lot of space. It's going to be a spacey place. I like that. I'm not claustrophobic. I'm almost the opposite. But I don't think I'd like to be closed up in a closet somewhere for 10 years. I'd probably go crazy. Most of us would. And so we need a lot of new things. We need a new place. And John 14 tells us that he's gone to prepare a place for us. And he's going to come again and receive us to himself. That where he is, there we're going to be also. That's a new place. And we can mention a whole lot of other things. But all things are going to be made new. And we'll live together with Jesus Christ. And all this newness and those worries and anxieties of the life will be forgotten. Solomon said in his writings in Ecclesiastes, he said, there's nothing new under the sun. But when Jesus comes, he will make all things new. And by grace through faith, we can be assured that this, because our verse ends with, these words are true and faithful. We can believe this. Are you made new? Are you a new creature in Christ? Are you looking forward to a new earth and a new heaven? Are you looking forward to the new things? This is a new year. And we can't help that because it just came. You know, we had no control over it. But if you'll trust the Lord today, if you're not saved, he'll save you right where you are. And then you'll be ready to go to this wonderful place that's new. Let's stand together for prayer.